We are still living in the aftermath of all the revelations about Paul Manafort and Michael Cohen. And we begin today with the sort of latest updates on the Michael Cohen situation, because Michael Cohen, it turns out, is the greater threat to the president of the United States than is Paul Manafort. To recap, Michael Cohen pled guilty to campaign finance violations, and he suggested that the president had informed him and told him to commit these campaign finance violations. He'd instructed him to create all these shell corporations and avoid going through normal disclosure routes in order to pay off two separate women, Karen McDougal and Stormy Daniels, with whom he had once had sex just before the election in order to impact the election. Now, there are a couple of cases today as to why this is not actually legal violation. One of those cases being made by Bradley Smith. I discussed this over the last couple of days. He's a former chairman of the Federal Election Commission. He has a piece over at the Washington Post about this. And what he basically argues is that it is not a campaign expenditure when you are paying off a former lover. His rationale is that this is a personal expenditure. You may be doing it for a variety of reasons. Maybe you're doing it because you want to avoid ticking off your wife. That was John Edwards' case. He said that he silenced Riel Hunter, remember the 2008 presidential candidate for the Democrats. He had knocked up a woman who was not his cancer-ridden wife, because John Edwards is a piece of human trash. And then he had basically had his donors pay the woman $1 million to shut up. That ended up coming out. He ended up being prosecuted for it. His case was that he was paying off Riel Hunter because he didn't want to tick off his wife. It had nothing to do with the election. That was dubious. He was tried on it. There was a hung jury, and he ended up basically getting off. Well, that's sort of the case that Bradley Smith is making. He is saying, under the theory that then-candidate Donald Trump's personal attorney, Michael Cohen, violated campaign finance laws by arranging hush money payments to women accusing Trump of affairs, the answer would seem to be yes to the question of whether a business owner running for political office deciding to pay bonuses to him, his employees, would be a campaign expenditure. He says that that's a problem, that we can't equate everything with a campaign expenditure. Everything you do in your own interest or that influences a campaign can't be a campaign expenditure. You decide to give your employees a bonus just before the election. That's not necessarily a campaign expenditure, because maybe you would have given that bonus to your employees in the absence of the campaign anyway. Bradley Smith says, regardless of what Cohen agreed to in a plea bargain, hush money payments to mistresses are not really campaign expenditures. It is true that contribution and expenditure are defined in the Federal Election Campaign Act as anything for the purpose of influencing any election, and it may have been intended and hoped that paying hush money would serve that end. The problem is that almost anything a candidate does can be interpreted as intended to influence an election, from buying a good watch to make sure he gets to places on time, to getting a massage so that he feels fit on the campaign trail, to buying a new suit so that he looks good on a debate stage. Yet having campaign donors pay for personal luxuries seems more like bribery than funding campaign speech. So he's making the case that basically this is not a campaign expenditure, this is a personal expenditure by the president of the United States. The test under FEC rules is the so-called irrespective test. The irrespective test says, would this expenditure have been made irrespective of whether the campaign was happening? And as I've argued, I think that there's a plausible case Trump could say, I would have made this expenditure anyway, because he has a long history of pressuring women to stay silent and paying women off to stay silent. Back in 2011, he basically threatened to sue In Touch magazine for printing an interview with Stormy Daniels, and they backed off and did not print the interview with Stormy Daniels about her affair with then reality television producer and star Donald Trump. So Trump has a case on these grounds. There's a secondary case here, and that's the case being made over at Politico by a bunch of legal experts. They say that Cohen's admission that he violated campaign finance law while acting at Trump's direction is far from rock solid proof that the president is also guilty, even if Cohen is being entirely truthful, some lawyers say. The fact that Cohen did something illegal doesn't mean Trump did anything illegal, said Jan Barron, a longtime Republican campaign finance lawyer. Cohen said in court on Tuesday that he acted at Trump's direction and violated federal election laws by arranging the payout to Stormy Daniels, an adult film actress, in the days before the 2016 election to keep her silent about what she said was an affair with Trump a decade earlier. Andrew Gruhl, however, a University of Iowa law professor, he says, under the law, it's quite easy for two people involved in the same act to have different criminal consequences. That distinction is particularly critical in campaign finance cases because the law limits criminal prosecution for campaign finance violations to instances where someone, quote, knowingly and willfully defied legal requirements. So in other words, if Trump called up Michael Cohen and he said, dude, I'd like for you to make this go away. And Michael Cohen says, don't worry, I'll take care of it. That is not Trump being complicit in a campaign finance violation because he assumes that Cohen knows all the legal requirements. If, however, Trump says to Michael Cohen, listen, I need you to make this go away, and it doesn't matter if you violate campaign finance law, or I know that we should shield this from public scrutiny by using a bunch of shell corporations, and let's say Cohen has him on tape saying all of that stuff, then it looks more like a criminal campaign finance violation. Cohen said under oath the most damaging information that the president of the United States committed a crime and covered it up, but that is not actually indicative that the president has criminal intent. So This one lawyer, Jan Barron, says, in order to prove criminal intent, you have to point to evidence that the actors knew or had reason to know that what they were doing was illegal. Trump can simply claim ignorance, and that may, in fact, be the case that he is making, right? That may be his strongest case. He sort of made that case a little bit yesterday. We'll get to Trump's response to all of this. So Trump has a couple of defenses that are relatively robust here. Defense number one, I pay off women all the time. This wasn't a campaign expenditure. Defense number two, even if it was a campaign expenditure, I didn't know the rules because I have people whose job it is to know that stuff. And I didn't order anyone knowingly to violate campaign finance laws because why the hell would I do that? Also a relatively strong defense. So ignorance and sluttiness are the president's two defenses. And both are quite plausible because the president gets around and has for a long time and has paid women to shut up for apparently a long time. And because the president is not exactly a legal expert, despite his own belief that he is. And President Trump is actually a terrible legal client because he thinks he knows more than his lawyers, which is always the first mark of a bad legal client. In fact, if God could have come up with a bad legal client in the laboratory before putting him on earth, he'd look a lot like Donald Trump, who just will not let his lawyers do their job. And Chuck Todd actually asked Lanny Davis, Chuck Todd over at MSNBC, asked Lanny Davis, who's Michael Cohen's lawyer, and this is the great irony, of course, is Lanny Davis was Bill Clinton's lawyer back during the impeachment scandal. So now he's flipped sides, and Lanny Davis is now going after the president. He is asked by Chuck Todd if there's any corroborative evidence that Michael Cohen is telling the truth, that when Michael Cohen says that Trump told him to violate campaign finance law, is there any evidence that corroborates this? Here was Lanny Davis's answer.
Does the SDNY have physical evidence in their hands that, or is this still on Michael Cohen's word versus the president's word?
If I was trying to give you your answer, Chuck, the answer is, number one, the Trump team and Mr. Giuliani have admitted that the money was paid. Number two, there is physical and electronic evidence that the money was paid to Ms. Daniels from the Trump conduit, who was Mr. Cohen, and it's all documented.
Okay, but that doesn't answer the question. Okay, we know that the money was passed along. The question is whether Trump had intent to avoid campaign finance law, and that is not actually documented, is what Lanny Davis seems to be saying. So just because the money passed hands, which we all assume happened, and just because Trump told Cohen to solve the problem, which we all assume happened, doesn't mean that Trump actually had intent to violate campaign finance law. Now, the great irony of this situation is that Hillary Clinton was allowed to get away with creating a private server and then destroying information on the private server, supposedly because she didn't have intent. Now, it's pretty clear she actually did have intent to destroy information and violate the law. But Trump probably didn't have intent here. And so by the same standard, he should probably not be criminally liable unless they have actual evidence that he knew that the law was being violated and he said, I don't care, go ahead and violate the law. Anyway, it also doesn't help that Michael Cohen happens to be a particularly sleazy liar and everybody sort of knows it. Right? The newfound respect for Michael Cohen's honesty is sort of astonishing from folks on the left. And you can see that folks on the left even really don't believe Michael Cohen. They think he's a liar and a screwball. Lanny Davis was on national television yesterday on NBC News. And he actually said that they had opened a legal defense fund for Michael Cohen. He asked people to contribute, and the audience started laughing at him. It's really funny.
But could I just take one opportunity to remind everyone that Michael Cohen has suffered a tragic and difficult experience with his family. He's without resources, and we've set up a website called MichaelCohenTruth.com that we're hoping that he will get some help from the American people so he can continue to tell the truth.
The audience is not, they don't know if you're ready to donate, Lanny, but we did check before we went to air.
And honestly, that's the appropriate response. By the way, his legal defense fund has raised like $150,000. It's raised a bunch of money. 50,000 of those dollars apparently came from the CEO of NASCAR for some odd reason that nobody can really explain. So all of that is good stuff. Again, the president has actually three pretty good defenses. Michael Cohen's a liar. Okay, fair enough. Michael Cohen is a liar. Two, I sleep with everyone and then pay them off. Also a fairly good defense. And defense number three, I don't know what the hell I'm doing with regard to legal stuff. He's my lawyer. It's his job to know that stuff. Also a pretty good defense. So all of the talk about Trump being necessarily legally on the ropes, maybe he is, maybe he's not. I mean, he's certainly more jeopardy than he was 2 days ago, but it's not indicative that this is sort of an open and shut case. Brett Stevens of the New York Times has a whole thing today about how Trump should immediately be impeached. The evidence isn't quite there yet of criminal action. We all knew that Trump is a man who lacks character in a lot of particular areas, but that's not the same thing quite as criminal activity. With all of this said, the strongest defenses the president has are, I get around, I'm dumb about the law, Michael Cohen's a liar, right? Those are his strongest defenses. His strongest defense is not, I am by nature a truth teller. That is not the president's strongest defense because he's not. Okay, let's just be honest about this. The president is not known for his veracity on a wide variety of issues. He may be at root a truth teller on some matters political. I think that's true. But he also likes to fib a fair bit. And so when Sarah Sanders got up, Sarah Huckabee Sanders yesterday at the White House, when she got up and she was asked whether Trump is lying, she got very offended and it didn't play all that great.
John, I'm here today and say the president has never lied to the American people, because so many people now look back at that tape of him on Air Force One saying he knew nothing about these payments, when in fact we now know he knew everything about these payments. So has he lied?
Look, again, I think that's a ridiculous accusation. The president in this matter has done nothing wrong and there are no charges against him.
Okay, so he's done nothing wrong. There are no charges against him. No charges against him is a bad defense. He never lies, a bad defense. It's offensive to ask whether he lied. He literally was on Air Force. I mean, what that reporter says is true. He was on Air Force One. He was asked about paying off Stormy Daniels and Karen McDougal. And he said, I had no knowledge that any of that stuff was happening. That was not true. Okay, so that's not his best defense. Again, I've laid forth three separate defenses for the president, all of which are fairly robust. His best defense is not, I can't be indicted and I never lie. That's not his best defense. But Sanders said repeatedly that Trump can't be indicted. Again, he can't be indicted probably because he's president of the United States, but that's not a case that he's not guilty of a crime. There are a bunch of other cases he's not guilty of a crime, but the statement that he can't be indicted, that's like saying, well, I was acquitted on a murder charge and then it turns out I actually murdered the person. I can't be tried again because of double jeopardy. Well, that's true. That is legally true. It also doesn't mean that you didn't necessarily murder the person. Here's like O.J. Simpson clearly murdered Nicole Simpson. He was acquitted and he can't be retried under double jeopardy. If somebody were to ask him, O.J., are you innocent of killing your wife? And he said, can't be tried again. You might assume, well, maybe he's a little bit guilty. Here is Sarah Huckabee Sanders, though, saying the president is innocent because he can't be indicted, which is, again, legally not tenable.
As the president said, we've stated many times, he did nothing wrong. There are no charges against him. As the president has stated on numerous occasions, he did nothing wrong. There are no charges against him in this. The president in this matter has done nothing wrong, and there are no charges against him. What the president has stated a number of times, he did nothing wrong. There are no charges against him.
I mean, so he just kept saying this over and over, right? He did nothing wrong. There are no charges against him. He did nothing wrong is a statement. You know, you can say he did something morally wrong, but he did nothing legally wrong. Would be the end of the case. There are no charges against him is not part of the case. There are no charges against him because he's the president of the United States, and you cannot, under federal law, have a federal law enforcement agency indict a sitting president of the United States. Okay,